and tell everybody. Go ahead and tell everybody. I'm the man, I'm the man, I'm the man. Yes, I am, yes, I am, yes, I am. I'm the man, I'm the man, I'm the man. I believe every lie that I ever told. Paid for every heart that I ever stole. I played my cards and I didn't fold. Well, it ain't that hard when you got soul. The words, but I still give my best. God made my mold different from the rest. Then he broke that mold, so I know I'm blessed. Stand up now and face the sun. Won't hide my tail or turn and run. It's time to do what must be done. Be a king when kingdom comes. Well, you can tell everybody. Yeah, you can tell everybody. Go ahead and tell everybody. I'm the man, I'm the man, I'm the man. Well, you can tell everybody. Yeah, you can tell everybody. Go ahead and tell everybody. I'm the man, I'm the man, I'm the man. Yes, I am, yes, I am, yes, I am. I'm the man, I'm the man, I'm the man. I got all the answers to your questions. I'll be the teacher, you could be the lesson. I'll be the preacher, you be the confession. I'll be the quick relief to all you stressing. It's a thin line between love and hate. Is you really real or is you really fake? I'm a soldier standing on my feet. No surrender and I won't retreat. Stand up now and face the sun. Won't hide my tail or turn and run. Tell everybody. Go ahead and tell everybody.
Salute, and welcome. Welcome back to the Black Ocean. And now swimming in the deep end with your host, the one and only Great Black Shark. Oh, ladies and gentlemen, we are going to make the alabaster portion of America highly irate tonight with this broadcast. Oh, yes, we are. First and foremost, I hope everyone that's joining us over here is doing well. I hope your families are well. May all of you be blessed and all of your endeavors well ahead of your stilts, because we're going to cover a couple of things about our dearly departed brother, OJ Simpson. Now, let me say at the onset of the broadcast, yes, we know the man wasn't perfect. If you look at some of the things that the Jew said, we understand that, yeah, you know, he was kind of doing a little tap dancing. But here's the difference, and I'm going to tell you why I'm doing this broadcast in defense of the man's legacy tonight. Because as you all know, if you're on social media, white supremacists was jumping up and down, celebrating the man's death. Boy, they ain't going to have too much to celebrate after tonight's broadcast, because you know I'm finna give them that work. But let me say this about OJ. We acknowledge the man's faults for what they were, but we also understand that if we're going to contrast him between somebody like a Candace Owens, he wasn't out there doing what Candace was doing. Okay? So that's my stance on that particular thing. And see, let me take a bit to say this too, to the brothers and sisters gathered in the audience over here tonight. We all know that life is short, okay? Relatively short. And what we should all want to remember is that, you know, whatever legacy we're going to leave behind, we should hope that it's one that our people in our community can be proud of. And OJ definitely left a legacy to be proud of with his accomplishments and certain things. Some of the stuff he said, yes, we understand. We took OJ to task for a lot of that. But we're going to get the lessons out of that for our community tonight. But we also going to deal with all these lies that these alabaster supremacists are running around here telling. Because, see, family, let me tell you something. One of the things that I like about their openness and the fact that a lot of these social media platforms, which are white supremacists control, we're on one of them right now. I like the fact that they're allowing them to spew their vitriol and hatred. Let me tell you why. Because, see, for those of us that are Gen Xers and older, we remember the OJ trial. I remember, you know, coming home in the 90s as a kid, my mother had me record it so that she could catch it when she got home from work and all of that. You know what I'm saying? Videotape on VHS. Yes, there was such thing as a VCR for you young folks. That's all, you know, man, what the hell is that? So those things actually exist. You know what I'm saying? I know it would look like an alien object to most of these kids today. But, you know, We all grew up watching that trial, basically. All right. We saw pretty much from the start of it to the end of it, right on up to the verdict. And I'm going to tell you why I'm glad that we see this reaction some 30 years later. It's a good reminder to our children that racism and white supremacy isn't just something that was a thing of the past. It's right here in your generation. Okay. I also want everybody to be able to get the lesson from it of got to go here. If you're going to deal with those particular women in Alabaster America, a lot of things will come with that you better be ready for. Take example, the Jonathan Majors case. You can be running away from them, not trying to harm them whatsoever, and they will still find something to convict you of for the mere fact that you was a Negro that had the audacity to be with one of these precious, innocent, dainty white women, okay? So there's going to be all types of lessons in here tonight. But I'm going to tell you, I got some footage that a lot of people have not seen. You know what? I ain't going to even tell y'all. I'm going to wait till we get to the broadcast. Just trust me, you in for a treat over here tonight as far as just the edification of knowledge and debunking a lot of this foolishness. Because, see, I'm going to go ahead and get into this at the onset. Fact of business, before I do that, let me mind my manners first and greet the brothers and sisters joining us over here. Oh, we're going to have a stacked broadcast tonight, family. Let me scroll up and greet everybody that I see joining us. I see a lot of y'all saying y'all like that intro. I had to play that one because let me tell you something. Brothers and sisters, but especially black men, that should be an anthem that if you ever down in your spirits, man, put that aloe black on the man on. And then after you finish listening to that, get up and get on your purpose. But let me greet this thing just guests joining us over here tonight. I see the brother Willis Martin over here. I see Patricia Slade in the building. Keith Prince is in the house. I see CRU Reality in here. I see Shalel Peterson. Patricia Jenkins, the wonderful and intelligent librarian. Sister Stun Zed in the building. D. Foster, Real Women Don't Do Nonsense. Love that name, sister. I see Amir L in here. I think I said, yeah, D Foster, I see you. I see Mrs. L, salute to you and your whole household, sister. Only Pamela's Way is in here. I see Bruce, Diesel Mike. I see Hot One in the building. Eric Parker, Jason Ferreira. I see Josh Norris, welcome young man. Opal Ivy, the sisters in the building. Seven Skills is with us. Dad Miller TV in the house. I see Mungo Slade. I see Blue Jay 3000, Project Leroy, my good brother on deck, Sidonian Snow. I see Sandra Evans in here. And I think that's everybody. Salute and welcome to all of you that's over here so far, and everybody will be joining us in attendance later on. And welcome to all of you that will catch it on the playback. So now, let me get straight to brass tacks about the foolishness. And my good brother still Kevin Cheese. Good, what's going on, brother? Hey, brother, if you ever decide to do that platform, let me know. You know, I'll promote the hell out of it over here. So, you know what I'm saying? We can get people up on the page. So just let me know when you do that. But let me go ahead and cut straight to brass tacks about the foolishness that they've been trying to propagate for 30 years, talking about OJ, you know, he was guilty. He did it. Oh, they found him guilty in the civil suit, as if a civil suit is indicative of criminality or being convicted of criminal behavior. Personally, I think that any type of civil suit, if you were found innocent in a criminal case, they should not be able to find you financially liable in civil court. But that's a whole nother broadcast for another day. Let's just talk common sense. Because see, we know we're in our right frame of minds as foundation of Black American freedom, and non-LBA people that want to see just them don't just go along with what white daddy and white mommy tell you. I said this before, and I'm going to be careful saying this because, you know, y'all know my military background and all of that, so I'm not going to go into specific detail, but I will start here as I did on the last broadcast. Yes, there is a such thing as being able to be skilled enough to kill two people with one knife. I'm not going to go into detail about how and all of that, but I will say this, OJ did not have that skill set. And even if you did kill two people with one knife, okay, if you had these particular skills, we're just going to make it make sense. The way that you would be able to have to do that, you would have to catch them off guard in a small enclosed area, and you would have to know exactly what you're doing and where to hit them with that knife to make sure that they're not able to scream, and it wouldn't be the neck. I'm not going to tell you how to do that or whatever. I'm not going to go into detail about that. But here's what you wouldn't be able to do, even if you pulled that off. You wouldn't, even if you knew how to coat a blade and make it hydrophobic. Yes, that can be done. I'm not going to explain how. Even if you were to able to coat a blade and make it hydrophobic where the blood wouldn't stick to it, you got a problem. You're not going to be able to kill them people like that in that manner and not get any blood on your clothes whatsoever. That's just impossible. They like to make us out to be super niggers, okay? In a 25-minute window time span, the ridiculousness about the brother putting on some dress shoes, a jogging pants, and a damn skull cap. See, let's talk about the skull cap thing. Family, what you need to do, or what I would suggest you do, if you have Black children, and salute to the good brother, Black Voltron Reloaded. Welcome, my brother, and I see you in here as well, Terry. What you need to do, family, if you got Black children, you need to take the time, and I'm gonna show you an important lesson a lot of people might not have mentioned. This case puts on blast how the greater majority of white supremacist America sees Black people, especially when you have the dynamic of a Black person, whether it's a man or a woman, especially the men, though. That's with them folks, especially the white woman. When you look at King Kong, okay, and you look at all the zombie movies, when you look at D.W. Griffith's A Birth of a Nation, this is how they really see us. You need to understand that they train their children to see Black people like these horrible, super powerful ultra boogeymen. They're going to get you no matter what. This, I know it sounds silly, but this is how these people see us, okay? So they have this thing in their minds where it's like, oh, that's one of the monstrous Negroes, boy. You know how dangerous they are, okay? The white supremacists lose their mind anytime they see a Black man, and for that matter, a Black woman, get with them folks, okay? But they're especially sensitive about their women being with brothers, all right? Now, y'all know my position on the interracial dating and the swirling. I don't advocate for it, but life is going to happen. Grown people going to do what they want to do. The point of the discussion here tonight is just looking at how these people see us, okay? So, the skull cap thing. Now, when you look at the stereotypes that they have about us being thugs and all of that, what does that tell you? See, we got to really break this down in a simplified way so that you understand how these people look at us. Because, see, let me show you something. Before we get started, let me show you something. Oh, yeah. Let me show you what the New York Compost put up. Oh, yeah. Look at this. The New York compost. Can everybody see that okay? If you can't, let me know and I will enhance it so that you can. And by the way, let me know if everybody can hear the audio clearly. Let me know if I need to adjust my sound any, and we'll get that taken care of. Give me a thumbs up in the chat if you can hear me clearly, family. Make sure I got my microphone adjusted, checking my levels on everything. Everything looks clear on my end, but it matters what you all, the audience, are able to hear. So if you're not able to hear me clearly, let me know and I'll get that adjusted, okay? So if you look at what you see on your screen here, this is the New York compost. That's right, I said compost. Football star actor, murderer, and this man was not convicted of murder. He's innocent. I know, white America, you can't grasp that, but it is. Murderer, liar, OJ Simpson, 76, real killer is dead. Now, remember Tim Scott and Kamami Harris? Oh, America isn't a racist country. Oh, really? So let's go here. See, I told you, we're going to be thorough here tonight. If America isn't a racist country, how can you be found innocent in the justice system, which they claim isn't perfect, but it's the best we got? And then after you're deceased, 30 years after you've been acquitted of something, they put up an article like this in the New York compost. And this is not the only one. This is just one. Okay? Yeah. Oh, this is real. This is really on the New York Post. You can verify it for yourself. Okay? So that's the question I want to pose. If America isn't a racist country, how is it that whenever the justice system, in the rare occasion that it does work for a black person and you're acquitted and found innocent, oh, that's just not good enough. Oh, the system must be broken. But on the other hand, to go to show you how Neely Fuller Jr. has taught us, white supremacy takes both sides of an argument. At the same time, oh, it's not perfect, but it's the best justice system we got, or as I call it, the injustice system. So I wanted to start and make sure you all saw that here tonight, okay? Oh, yeah, because see, y'all seen the vitriol that they have online. Okay, oh, they running around, they losing their mind, they can't stand it. Oh boy, it's just eating them up. They don't know what to do with themselves. Let me tell you white supremacy something. No matter what you think about OJ, no matter what things OJ might have said that we've taken him to task for in our own community, which is our community's business. We always deal with our in-house situations in-house. Here's the thing that you all gotta live with. You will never, most of you wishing death on this man, wish celebrating the man's death, and a lot of you was wishing for his death before he died. You will never achieve a tenth of the success that OJ did. You ain't gonna have half as much recognition. You're not going to accomplish anything in your own community amongst your own people where they will raise you up to that level, even in a society where it's designed for you to fail up. So I just want you to understand that. I just want you to understand it, because see, before this broadcast ends tonight, I got something special for you. We're going to save it to when the most people are in here. Oh, I got something special for you. So I just wanted to get that out of the way. But ladies and gentlemen, we're going to examine some things over here tonight. And as usual, we're going to stop it and break it down as need be, because we got a lot of ground to cover. So with that said, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to get started.
Why is white America still infatuated with the OJ Simpson verdict? I would argue, in the premise of my message today, is white people in their eternal contradictions and double standards. White America in its eternal contradictions and double standards can't let the OJ verdict go, because under the rule of white supremacy and through the practice of white privilege, especially as it pertains to the criminal injustice system, white people almost always get whatever they want. When it comes to black folk, when we go back to Reconstruction, when we go back to slavery, when we go back to Jim Crow, and even when we look at the criminal injustices against black people today, we see that white folks always get a guilty verdict whenever they want one. So this whole outcry by white America against the OJ Simpson verdict, what is this infatuation? This infatuation grows out of a privilege that says when a white man is guilty and the alleged, when a black man is accused of being guilty, when a black man is accused of being guilty and the alleged victim is white, 99.9% of the time, the black man is convicted. And white people are angry because they always get what they want from the criminal justice system. And this time, they did not get what they want from the criminal justice system. This is why they're upset. It's not about justice.
I couldn't have put it better than the words of our good brother, Dr. Umar Johnson. And yes, regardless of what issues you have with him, I always said it for years on this channel, regardless of whether I agree or disagree with some of his ideology, the man is absolutely brilliant. And he's on point with what he just said. He's absolutely right. Anytime the so-called justice, or as we call it, the injustice system, does not work exactly the way they want it to convict and railroad a black person, oh, now it's everything's falling apart. It's just not right at all. And see, what you're looking at on this screen here, you know, I always put this image on the screen. This is the serpent, the alabaster serpent that represents white supremacist America and the entire injustice system here in this country. Okay, and again, I'm talking about the white supremacists. So if you're a white person and you're not a white supremacist, I'm not talking about you. Getting that out of the way early. But see, here's the thing, family. When it comes to that, here's what I must also say as well, okay? And to answer the question of Patricia Slade, isn't the picture against the law, can his family sue? Well, sister, unfortunately, you can't sue for libel and slander when somebody passes and they're deceased. In most states, you can't do that. So they wouldn't be able to sue about that. You know, now if he was lit, see, that's why they didn't do it while he was alive too. That's a lesson I want y'all to remember. That's why they came at Michael Jackson the way they did, because see, they wouldn't have dared try to say all that stuff while he was alive. He would have sued the shit out their ass and won easily. People will wait till you die to go to show you the despicability of white supremacy. Okay. And see, this is why I have the snake on the screen here, because see, they're duplicitous. They're always lying. And like, then they wonder why they're dealing with a lot of things that they're dealing with in society today, that really, it ain't going to be no reversing unless the Most High decide to do that. But let's just be honest with what a lot of them have done over the years worldwide. It's chances are slim to none that they're going to be able to reverse things, because there are people that prove time after time that they're not about any type of justice. You can't have just the sum of the time for some people and then for everybody else, there's no justice at all. And then actually have the nerve to be sitting up in places that they call houses of God and claim to be God's children. Get out of here with that. It doesn't work that way, white supremacists. And I'm going to prove that here tonight. Oh, yes, I am. Y'all know me. When I lay out a case, I'm thorough with it. Okay. So I got something else we got to examine here, family, because see, yeah, I'm finna make them mad over here tonight. They ain't seen nothing yet.
That voted to acquit OJ because of Rodney King?
Yes.
You do?
Yes.
How many of you think felt that way?
Oh, probably 90% of us.
90%? Did you feel that way?
Yes.
That was payback.
Uh-huh.
You think that's right?
It was payback against white people. And again, for you millennials and Zoomers who weren't alive back.
Now, y'all saw that clip, right? Now, family, I'm going to ask you a question. Because, see, we got to teach our young people the right way. And, see, this is why I gave the examples that I did about how they see black people and how they lie. And, like my great-grandfather told me, if they pale, thin lips are moving, they lying. Everybody that's in here right now that heard me play that clip, and if you need me to play that back again, I'll play it again. Did this black woman say that was payback for white people? Did anybody hear that black woman say that was payback for white people? I'm waiting. I want somebody to let me know in the chat. Sound off. Did you hear her say that was revenge? Did you hear her say, oh, we doing this to get back at white people? But yet, that's what came out his pale, thin, earthworm-shaped lips. You see how they just put words in your mouth and just run with the lie? So now here's the other thing about it. White supremacist America. I told you, I'm going to hurt your feelings over here on this broadcast tonight. I'm going to make you not only look like the lying serpents that you are, but I'm going to show how incompetent and evil, demonically insane that you are. They'll sit there and just make up something. But see, here's why this is so dangerous. And for all the people that are talking about ain't no white supremacy, it's one thing if one of them says it. But when they all get together and repeat the same lie, when they have power backing them, as they do in the judicial system, okay, and the legislative branch, so on and so forth, and every facet of this society, that's where you get your systematic white supremacy from. And we'll sit there and tell that lie with a straight face, and then listen to what he's about to say next. That's most important. I'm going to let this play, then I'm going to come back with some more commentary on this.
back then, you couldn't find a single black person in America who wasn't cheering OJ on and hoping that he would be found innocent in order to stick it to white people.
Now, you notice what he just did in their family. He immediately pivoted to talk to Generation Z and younger that wasn't around to poison them. See, let me talk to you young white people that might happen to find their way over on this broadcast, the ones of you that aren't white supremacists, because there are some young white people, believe it or not, that come over into new black media spaces to learn the truth. See, this is why I don't put them all in the same boat. I understand that a majority of them in the country are like that. But see, with the younger generation, you do have some, because I've run into them. A lot of them will come into our space, and these are the ones that you can tell that come in and they don't troll in different new black media platforms. They just dare to learn the truth because, see, they get tired of being lied to. And once you get a certain age as a child in any race and you see something's not right, you're going to go search for the truth. So he's trying to poison their minds. And see, this is why the system of white supremacy has lasted for so long. They keep telling lies. And then to go to show you how you don't have a high IQ, I want everybody to remember what I'm about to say next. This debunks the whole they have a high IQ lie. If you have a high IQ, when you start to see that something's been repeated over and over and over and you never question anything, let me say that again. When you see something's repeated over and over and over again and you never question it, see, this is what we all tell you on New Black Media, any of our platforms, this is one thing I can speak for all of us on. We tell you to question everything we put out. Check it out. See if it adds up. We provide links, sources, dates, times. We don't tell you to just believe what we say. We want you to question us so that you make the truth your own and search it out for yourself. With white supremacy, nobody's ever supposed to do that. Yet they tell you you have a high IQ. So here's my question. If you claim to have a high IQ and you never seek to verify things, how smart does that really make you? Oh, it hurts, don't it? Oh, it hurts when somebody put it to you like that. But see, let me take this banner down. Because see, we got to deal with Lamore Shield over here, who I will never respect due to his disrespect of our ancestor and queen, mother, grandmaster, teacher, Dr. Francis Chris Wilson. You can go to hell for that. I'm never going to forgive him for that. Not telling y'all what to do, but that's my stance on it. Look at this buck dancing buffoon, because he's just one of many. But y'all know I had to highlight this. Let us read Mark Lamore Shield's quote here. Quote, OJ Simpson was an abusive liar. Who abandoned his community long before he killed two people in cold blood. His acquittal for murder was the correct and necessary result of a racist criminal legal system, but he's still a monster, not a martyr, end quote. Mark Lamoist, let me say this to you, you spineless bastard, you. If you're going buck dance, don't straddle the fence. Go full coon with it. Don't straddle the fence. Because you're doing that to get the approval and pass on ahead from white folks. Because, see, let's be clear. Whether it's him or Candace Owens, because they two sides of the same coin, they just bend over for different masters. He bends over for the liberals. She bends over for the so-called conservatives, okay, in Alabaster America. One thing I will give credit to Candace for over you, Mark Lamoist. She bent all the way over. She didn't halfway do it. She's like, hey, I'm going to throw my lot in with Zaddy and his people. Now, of course, she tried to come slithering back, but we're like, you got a gray and striped tail. Stay your raggedy ass over there with Alabaster Master. That's where you get to stay. Where you lay is where you stay. That's what I always say. Not telling y'all what to do, but that's how I look at it. Mark Lamoist, you got one foot in, one foot out, trying to pretend as if you for justice, but yet you parroting the same narrative. Nah, man, let me tell you something. They respect you even less when you do that. So whatever angle you going for, whatever you trying to get, it's not going to work, Lamoist. It's not going to work, buddy. Oh, it ain't going to work for you at all. It's not. So, you know, this type of spineless buck dancing buffoons we got out here like Mark Lamoist with this goofiness he got going. Because, see, family, I'm going to tell you something. One of the things why we don't take any disrespect from these white supremacists or these tethers, mostly as a collective, when I say this, because I'm not saying that all of us are perfect, there's good and bad in every demographic, but we're talking about in contrast to white supremacists America and globally, we have a moral compass to the point where we don't sit up here and do these things. Think about it. How many times? And see, I told you, I'm gonna tell the truth to Shane Devil over here tonight. Family, how many times have you ever seen a white child get killed in a horrific manner and black people go around on social media putting up memes about it, especially if it was a horrific murder? You don't see our people doing that. You ever notice that? See, I told you, I'm really going to prove my point over here tonight about how demonically insane these degenerates are and white supremacists in America and how worthless that makes a buck dancing sambo like Martin Lamoise Hill or Candace Owens when they just parrot everything these people say. Because, see, this is the thing about the sambozos and sambits, like sambozettes, like Candace Owens. They'll say whatever them people want them to say. If them people change their mind tomorrow and say, oh, man, we for justice, they'll be right there along with them. I know it. I've seen them flip-flop on several positions. According to, see, they go by not convictions, but by who they're trying to please. But see, when it comes to white supremacist America, in contrast to us, we actually have a conscience because we don't mess around. Yes, Mark Lamont is Caribbean. Yes, he is a tether. Yep, I'm glad you asked that, Ms. Zell. He's a Caribbean tether. He sure is. We're going to put him where he belongs. But see, you don't ever see us celebrating horrific murders of innocent children and things like that. Regardless of the issues we have with the dominant society, we still have a soul. But see, not them. And I'm going to prove that here tonight because, see, I got some audio I want to play here. Got some audio I want to play. In fact, let me put this up, show you where it's going to come from. I want y'all to take a listen to this.
Without Rodney King, would there have been...
Hold tight, hold tight. You know what? Let me make sure that I got this right. Wait a minute. I jumped ahead of myself. I had that mixed up. But, you know, because see, I almost forgot a sambozo. See, I'm so ready to get on these folks tonight, man. Because see, look, I expected of the white supremacists. I got to get these buck dancing buffoons. And this is another Caribbean buffoon we got to get on before we get to what was mentioned on Club Shay Shay. We're going to take our time and get there. Let me get on this horseshoe crab hairline having Negro right here. Stephen A. Smith, let me tell you something. Before I let him speak, I'm making this clear to you and all the tether class, and I'm going to be one of the main voices of the new black media to really clamp down on that going forward. You do not speak for foundational black American freedmen. This whole thing, just because you went disgracefully wearing, might I add, disgracefully wearing the same uniform as us, that doesn't mean you represent us. We doing this thing by lineage, baby. Y'all been delineating for the longest. We late to the party, and that's what it's going to be. Now, you were right. We concede that you're right. You say you Caribbean American. That's what you're going to be. That's what you're going to be. So you don't speak for us. I'm going to play this family, then I'm going to come back with my commentary on horseshoe crab hairline having Negro right here.
An OJ acquittal?
I don't think so. I don't think so. I think if Rodney King had not happened, that's just my personal opinion, Laura. I don't know for sure. But I'm just of the mindset that had Rodney King not happened, then OJ, a not guilty verdict for OJ, probably would not have happened. And listen, when I think about Nicole Brown Simpson and I think about Ronald Goldman, especially Ronald Goldman, of course, both lives being lost, so heart-wrenching and what have you. You don't wish that on any, if you're a human being with any kind of soul, you don't wish that on anybody. Let's be clear about that. But to see Ronald Goldman's father, to know that he had no relationship with OJ, and the perception is that he just came by and he was in the wrong place in the wrong time, and to have that happen to him, and for Nicole Brown Simpson to reportedly having had to endure what she endured from OJ for years, and then for that to happen, your heart just goes out to them. But unfortunately, at that particular moment in time, black folks were saying, there's a lot of lives that have been lost from our community at the hands of transgressors who happen to be law enforcement officials. And that was a more pertinent and profound issue in the African-American community than O.J. Simpson and Nicole Brown Simpson with Ronald Goldman. I mean, Jay-Z said it best when, you know, listen, we didn't have black folks. And I think, I don't want to speak for you, but it's hard to imagine that a black...
Let me stop him right here. Oh, you don't want to speak for her, but you're comfortable speaking for us. Now, see, let me go ahead and get started dealing with the problems in this segment right here. See, this is why for those that be like, well, it don't matter what you call yourself. Yes, it does. Because, see, that term African-American or just the term Black American alone is not making it clear who we talking about. That lumps these tethers in like horseshoe crab hairline here in with us. And then they purport to speak for us. Let's go ahead and deal with this. Regardless of whether Rodney King would have happened or not, that's two things separate and apart from themselves. That was the right verdict at the end of the OJ trial for several reasons. We're going to get to that later here tonight. Oh, yes, we are. We definitely going to get to why that was the right verdict. Oh, we're going to get there. And, man, shout out to the good brother, Still Kevin Trees. He said, Stephen A., the only Negro in this decade who hairline still trying to move on us. Kevin Trees, you're going to have to start that platform, bro. I'm telling you, that's hilarious, man. He got a George Jefferson hairline, family. Boy, listen, Kevin, I'm going to stay on you till you start that platform, brother. You better drop the link to me today so I can promote that. Moving on up, Georgia. He do, man. Man, boy, hairline sitting up here, man, looking like a doggone escalator, steadily moving backwards. Man, but anyway, like I said, you're not going to be sitting up here speaking for us, because regardless of what happened with Rodney King, that had nothing to do with the OJ verdict. It wasn't some payback we trying to tit for tat with white people. They rendered the right verdict based on everything that we're going to review later here, which was the right decision. Because, see, one of the things that's important about new black media and as black parents, okay, as black parents with children, while you recount the truth about things like the OJ trial, even though it was 30 years old, one of the most consistent things, and this is fortunate for us, okay, that white supremacy has not changed the playbook on, they're always trying to rewrite history and omit the truth. All the time, all over the world. So if you don't have people like myself and many other brothers and sisters that will call them on their lies, and thank goodness for the blessing of technology where we're not beholden like we were in the 90s, where we didn't have all this technology where we could debunk them in seconds and go back and fact check them ourselves and spread information amongst each other. Now we can. Now we're not at the mercy of having to wait weeks or years to get the truth. So that's the big advantage and the biggest blessing for, like, the I generation, Generation Z, rather, that's always had the internet in their lives. We must teach them how to use it as a tool of justice. And you do that by recounting the history of this. And also, here's what's most important, not only when it comes to issues of justice, but to our creation. So you don't get the Fat Joes and the Joe Conzos and the Dr. Derek Colognes or Derek Capon, like I call them, because he always was lying to Latinos. That's why I call them Latinos, those particular ones. You chronicle everything and keep an account and a record of it amongst your people, which should be easier to do today because you got all different methods of media to preserve it all so that you know the truth and nobody can come rewrite your history, okay? See, history is very important, like I said many times, in correlation to present day and the future. But see, I'm going to let this horseshoe crowd I have it having fools over here continue speaking. And we ain't done with them by sight. Like I said, this broadcast is going to be very thorough. And I got some stuff coming over that some of y'all probably never seen before, paying honor and tribute to our good brother, Johnny Cochran.
A black person in America didn't remember OJ saying, "I'm not black, I'm OJ." You know, he wasn't somebody that ingratiated himself with our community. You know, I'm not happy that the man is dead. I'm not happy that he passed away from cancer. I lost my mother to cancer in 2017. I'm very, very sensitive to that issue. I don't wish death upon anybody. But in the same breath, this was a man that had detached himself from his community. He was the first black athlete ever given a national ad.
Now, let me stop him right here, and look at his face where I got it paused on this shot. Because, see, y'all know me. Even my pauses, when I give my commentary, are strategic. The irony of him saying he detached himself from his community. Steven, if ever the horseshoe crab hairline pot was calling the kettle black, where you think you at with us? Huh? Come on, family. See, nobody probably ever pointed that out. I'm not sure. But where you think you in with the black community, Stephen? Do you think that? See, some of these Sam Bozos and Sam Bits are so far gone, they don't look in the mirror at themselves and their own little gray and black striped tails with their little bandit mask on. No, you not over here with us. You right over there with Candace. He must think he's in. Family, let me ask a question. Does he think he's in? Is that what he's thinking, family? Does he think he's in with us? Is that what he's thinking? I'm trying to figure it out now because he's talking like he good money. Like, look, let me ask you a question. I'm gonna take a live poll right here real quick with my audience. Family, can Stephen A. come around any of y'all and be received warmly and you trust him? And I'm not advocating no violence against him. I'm just saying, can the man come around anywhere in your community and be good money? Can he? For the audience that I got gathered in, I just want to see what the people that I got in. Somebody answer that question for me. Y'all let me know. I need to understand. If Stephen A. came around just out of the blue You seen him somewhere? How many of y'all read on? Oh, boy, Stephen A. Yeah, boy. Boy, you do so much representing our community, man, and standing up for black folks. Could he come around? Okay. See, my chat room is sounding off. That's what I thought. Because look, I ask these questions of my audience while I'm live because I might have it wrong. Y'all might say, hey, GBS, you tripping, man. We love that old horseshoe crab hairline having buffoon. Lay off our boy. But I just want to make sure, you know what I'm saying? Because he talking like he in there. The nerve of this dude, boy. The coontastic irony of it all. Let's let it continue.
Campaigned by Hertz in 1975. He prided himself on being different and separate and apart from his own race of people. These are facts. And so when you look at it from that perspective, and the only time it appeared he found his blackness was when he was indicted on double murder charges and he needed the support of the black community. You did have a lot of white folks in America looking at the black community like we were absolute fools for being supportive of him in any way.
Here we go with that French again. This is the same man that said, the first thing I do when I wake up in the morning is to figure out how can I make my boss more money. The first thing I do when I wake up in the morning is figure out how to make my boss more money and how can I get some of it. That's what he said. This little bowl weevil head looking buffoon right here actually said that, and you gonna have the nerve to talk about OJ? I got to go scriptural on you now. Extract the rafter from your own eye before you try to extract the straw out your brother's eye. And I'm going to say it again. OJ's cooning was more personal than tap dancing with some of his stuff, but he ain't never come out like you or Candace completely disparaging the black community. OJ just said, look, I'm going to put my tap shoes on and I need my white women. I'm going to leave it at that. I can't find any statements where he just completely trashed the black community. Can somebody help me out? Because maybe I missed it. His tap dancing is cooning. We called him out for that when the man was alive. But now he's no longer with us. Okay? The man said what he said, and he loved them white women. That was it. But he ain't really come out with black-on-black crime and none of that. I can't remember none of that stuff, okay? So, Stephen, cut that French out your dialect. We're going to have to educate them on this French here. Let's let it continue.
Because they knew that about him as much as we did.
So there you have it with the horseshoe hairline crab having buffoon right there. And salute to, Zay. So for the cash app, I got that right. Salute to Zay for the cash app. Appreciate you very much. I hope I'm pronouncing that right. I couldn't see all of what your name was. But see, those buck dancing buffoons like Stephen Horseshoe Caroline have having a Smith here, okay? This is what they own. Like Lamar Shield, you are auditioning for a job, you're buck dancing, tap dancing. But see, now we're going to get to the part that I was telling y'all about, you know, just a difference between class between people. I want y'all to listen to what was said here on Club Shay Shay, but the Nightcap. With Shannon Sharp and our old boy Ocho over here. But Shannon hit the nail on the head, and see, this goes to further underscore the difference between us and the dominant society as far as being the moral compass of America and actually having some dignity as a people that are not demonically insane, that stand up for injustice and make statues to slave masters, murderers, rapers, and killers, you know, kind of like they do with most of the Confederacy and Nathan Bedford Forrest, the founder of the Ku Klux Klan, some of the most demonic and insidious villains of all time, furthest thing from anything being godlike or upright or just promoting justice. They have monuments, statues, buildings, and holidays named after these people, like that demon Christopher Columbus. We don't go idolize demonic figures amongst black folks like that or any race of people. We're the main ones that call that out. So yeah, I told you I'm gonna be thorough with this, but see, I want y'all to hear what the brother Shannon Sharp is gonna say here on this podcast. I'm going to play this audio and I'm going to give some commentary at different parts.
Orenthal James Simpson, one of the greatest running backs of all time, had succumbed to prostate cancer. He was fighting a long battle of cancer. He was at the age of 76. OJ Simpson, known for his football prowess on the days of use at USC and the Buffalo Bills. Later, he's more infamously known for going on trial for the murder of his ex-wife, Nicole Brown Simpson, mm-hmm. and her friend, Ronald Goldman. He was acquitted of the criminal trial, but later convicted on civil charges. Caitlyn Jenner tweeted, let's take a look at the tweet. Do we have it up? We're going to have it up, Ash. Sorry for the delay, but Caitlyn Jenner tweeted, very tacky, very distasteful.
Yes.
Basically what it said was good riddance. No matter what you think of someone, Ocho, you don't celebrate someone's death.
You never do that. You never do that. It's one thing about God. God don't play. You don't celebrate nobody's death. Even if you despise that person based on personal issues y'all might have gone through. Now you have to remember. Now, OJ, murder, the case, he was acquitted, but obviously
acquitted.
Was tried in the civil case.
Mm-hmm.
Now, also, again, God don't like ugly. If I'm not mistaken, sister, brother, Caitlyn Jenner also had an issue. 2015, fatal car accident. Kill somebody.
What? Hold on. No, you didn't.
Yeah,
no, she didn't. Now, everything in that OJ, people allegedly he killed Nicole Brown Simpson and Ronald Goldman.
Yes, sir.
He went on trial. 12 men and women, a jury of his peers says we don't believe he did it.
Yes, sir.
Beyond a reasonable doubt.
Right.
They acquitted him. He went to trial on the civil charges. He was convicted. So you mean to tell me there's no denying that at the hands of Caitlyn Jenner, someone lost their life?
Yes, sir.
How would she feel? Now, if I'm not mistaken, I don't recall her spending not one day in jail.
Yes, sir.
But you say good riddance. You happy for the death. You know, God don't like, my grandma used to always say when I was a little boy, Ocho, God don't like ugly.
No.
Sometimes he don't like pretty.
Yeah.
And you better be careful.
You got to be careful because you never know your time is up. Every time we're born, we all come with an expiration date. Now, we don't know when that day is, but what you don't want to do is you don't want to speed it up because the tongue is powerful. If you're going to celebrate somebody else, listen, if you're going to celebrate somebody else's death, now you got to be careful. And God can show you better than he can tell you.
Yes, absolutely. Ocho, I'm a little older than you.
I'm 56, OJ. Man. Come on, man. I was there. OJ, I'm not going to tell you. I can tell you where I was, but go ahead and bring it. I'm going to fall back. I'm going to piggyback off of you.
If you're probably around my age.
Yes, sir.
Maybe a little older. OJ Simpson was the guy.
Oh, yeah.
I'm talking about OJ Simpson. We're not talking about what transpired in 94.
Mm-hmm.
Coming forward, we're talking about prior
on the field.
If you played running back, you wanted to get the number 22. You wanted to be the juice, because he was really the first black athlete to have commercial success. Everybody remember OJ running through the airport, jumping over everything.
Yep, I tried that once.
He sold cars. He had an orange juice commercial. He was really the first black and TV. Remember OJ with what was that movie that he was in with
Naked Gun Montgomery? The Naked Gun.
No. He was in Naked Gun.
Oh, but
he was
funny.
In a movie with Elizabeth Montgomery. What was the name of that movie? It wasn't Burning. It was A Killing Affair.
Mm.
Yeah, OJ got credits, major credits on his resume.
Yeah.
So he was really the first black athlete to have commercial appeal. Now, we know Muhammad Ali, but Muhammad Ali didn't have the commercial appeal because of what transpired of him becoming a Muslim and not wanting to go to Vietnam. He's like, they Viet Cong, they ain't call me no N-word. I ain't going over there killing them innocent people. Well, y'all want me to fight over there, but y'all won't fight for me right here.
Mm.
OJ had commercial appeal.
Right.
And so everybody, dudes like healthy dudes, chubby dude, man, I want to be running back. Man, get your fat butt on the offensive and defensive line. You ain't getting no 22. They ain't got but one 22, OJ, Ocho. And this dude, you 200 pounds, talking about you going to be a running back.
Running back, yeah.
Come on, bro.
Yeah.
OJ was it. Now, a lot of people try to erase what he did on the field.
Right.
Because of what transpired in 1994.
Yeah.
Now, I'm going to pause it right here. This is one thing that I'm going to have to interject. When we say a lot of people, let's call out who the people were. A lot of white supremacist America want to erase what he did on the field. I don't hear any black folks that are Especially at the black folks that are foundational black Americans. It's mostly Tillers trying to erase all of that and side with the white supremacists and just act as if, okay, because this man was accused and acquitted of these things, okay, you just wipe them out of history books. See, they only do that with us. Let's name some names, shall we? Pete Rose. Oh, I'm going there. Mark McGuire. Oh, I'm going there. Yes, I am. Chad Wheeler, even though they finally locked him up, are they racist? I'm just giving a few names. Okay, Roman Polanski. Oh, we can take it out of sports. We sure can. Oh, man, Kevin Spacey. Oh, come on now. Hey, hey, Charlie Sheen. Oh, come on. We got to talk about this. When their folks do things and are accused of things, they even found guilty of them. Do they completely throw them out of the history books with the things they accomplished? Even though Harvey Weinstein is in jail right now, in prison right now, rather. Do you see them saying, let's completely dismiss everything he's ever done because of these things? That's only reserved for black folks. So I just want to make sure we call out who it is that's doing that. Let's let it continue.
I believe, look, everybody knows what he did. He ran the football the first. He rushed for 2,000 yards in 14 games.
Mm-hmm.
And 14 in Buffalo. You know what the weather gets like in Buffalo. You ever played in Buffalo, Ocho?
Yeah, I played in Buffalo twice. Boy, it was cold now.
Okay, it's so cold. You know. And New York, it gets cold in New York.
Yeah, it does.
So I just, like I said, I don't celebrate them. Mm-mm. No matter what you think he may or may not have done, I'm still not celebrating his death. Because I just know one thing. In 1994, three families' lives changed forever.
Yeah.
OJ kids never had peace because everybody looked at them with a side eye and a jaded eye.
Yeah.
Nicole Brown Simpson, her family was never the same.
Mm-hmm.
Ron Goldman, family was never the game, same. They never were ever going to be able to hug their loved ones and tell them, I love you.
Mm-hmm.
So I empathize with the families.
Yeah.
But I don't celebrate someone's death.
Yeah, you got to be careful.
That's not my place to judge. I you know, first of all, and we're not going to we're not going to retry the case. First of all, it's 30 years ago. And second of all, we're not qualified.
No, at all.
And there you heard it, family. And I couldn't have put it better myself. Because, see, I'm going to underscore something, family. See, to go to show you how demonic the white supremacists are, demonically insane. Let me make sure I say that also, because that's exactly what they are. Go to show you how demonically insane they are. Instead of them using logic and common sense and looking at the facts and the evidence and a lot of stuff that we're about to get ready to review now, so that they could catch and prosecute the real killer, because it's a black man, they rather say, you know what? Never mind that. We got a Negro here that we want to pin it on, even if it's shown by this brilliant, outstanding, legendary example of what a competent black attorney is. Lord knows we need more of him. The only other brother that would come close to him would be the dearly departed Alton Maddox. Okay. Johnny Cochran, the brilliance of this man, okay? Oh, we're going to give our brother his flowers here tonight, and we're going to recount some of his brilliance because, see, we sorely missing that in the black legal class. We just got to tell that and call it like it is. We're missing that. But, see, instead of them trying to actually go after who did it that was running around free, never mind if they out there free to kill other people, nah, you're going to try to make a square peg fit in a round hole when you clearly see that it doesn't. We're going to take a look at some things, family, and before the night is over, trust me, y'all going to see some stuff that you probably never saw anywhere before, because, see, I got an important message when we get to that part about the power of you being a person that represents your people well, and the power of being somebody that stands up for what's right as far as justice and the truth is. It goes far beyond the reaches of America. We're going to play some things and break some things down. I want y'all to prepare to take notes on this, because some of this y'all probably had never seen before.
Do you think that race played a role in the OJ Simpson trial? I think it did, because I think race plays a part of almost everything that we deal with in America. For instance, I'll give you a couple of examples. Early on, you'll remember that Time magazine darkened Mr. Simpson's face to make him look more sinister. And then, of course, when the prosecution decided to call Detective Furman, they're the ones who called him. They know about his background. Mm-hmm. So that race, you know, in subtle ways, they would always talk about O.J. Simpson, football icon, married to the beautiful blonde Nicole Brown Simpson. So there were very many subtleties, you know, all the way through. The issue, I think, was at the end, African-Americans and some other people saw this as a victory for the system. They saw a case where there was reasonable doubt, where the case was not decided on race, but based upon the lack of evidence by the prosecution, and that here was a man, because of his resources, who had the benefit of the presumption of innocence. Many white Americans saw it a little bit differently. They saw what they perceived to be an injustice. But, you know, to them I point out the fact that when William Kennedy Smith was acquitted in 70 minutes, nobody cried about changing the system. When John DeLorean was acquitted, even being on video, nobody talked about changing the system.
What do you say to those who say that Black stood by Simpson, but he was not really Black, he was white in everything he did?
Well, you know, that's always a tough thing. Let me say this, that I think that in the days and weeks and months ahead, you're going to see O.J. Simpson emerge and show more concern about the African-American community. Mm-hmm. He realizes, Felicia, the great amount of support he got.
Was he guilty?
He really was innocent. I believe that, Felicia, with all my heart. From the very beginning, he maintained his innocence. And everything he had us check out always turned out to be that he was correct. And I think you're going to find in the civil case, when he testifies in the civil case, mm-hmm. people are going to be very, very surprised. He's a very compelling, credible witness.
Can America learn something from South Africa in terms of race relations?
I think that the experiment that's going on here in South Africa of the racists trying to get along, of working together in this multiracial society where it's a black majority, in fact, speaks volumes about what we can.
Hanson, I'm a lawyer.
So now I'm going to pause it right here, because in case you're wondering, yes, this was our good brother, Johnny Cochran, that went all the way to South Africa to represent our people and talk about this case. Okay. And for those wondering, the sister, that the South African sister he was talking to, her name is Felicia Mabuza Suttle. I think I'm pronouncing that right. Felicia Mabuza Suttle. She's a talk show host, or was at the time, over there. So the brother, Johnny Cochran, went over there and he was like, you know what? I'm going to represent our people well, far beyond our borders, because this trial right here. See, for those of you that don't travel, y'all don't understand. When something happens to those of us who are foundational Black American freedom, the entire world pays attention, especially with a trial of that magnitude. So see, this is something else I want to put on y'all minds tonight and impress upon y'all. A lot of y'all probably never thought, okay, how do our brothers and sisters across the way view what happened to O.J. Simpson? What are the lessons they would learn from this? Okay. So I've got something else that y'all might not have seen in regards to exactly what I'm talking about. I'm going to let this play, and I'm not going to give any commentary while this is playing. I want y'all to absorb this. This also is on that sister's talk show, Felicia Mabuza Suttle, the South African sister. I want y'all to take a listen to this.
A part-time judge in Atlanta. The O.J. Simpson trial was not a trial. It was a media event. From the minute that they broke into our basketball game finals, and we had to watch O.J. in a Ford Bronco and see the flashes of his beautiful blonde wife on the screen, it was a media event. Mm-hmm. It capitalized on everything bad with race relations in America. Mm-hmm. The way we feel about the police, the way we feel about interracial relationships, and the way we feel about even the media. It was some of the worst lawyering that I've seen. And the way it came out was the way we do verdicts in America. The jury seemed to believe that the prosecution did not prove its case. And in America, the only thing that you can do is find the defendants not guilty. And that is what the jury did. I was in a shopping mall, however, when the verdict was released in a predominantly black area in Atlanta, and there was support. There was jumping up and down in the middle of the mall, when the verdict was released. And a lot of people did feel that O.J. was unfairly treated, and it was just a bad media event.
As a judge, was he guilty or not guilty?
Well, I think the case was not proven, and I think that's what the jury found, and that in our American system, that is all that they could do.
Mm-hmm. On the OJ trial, my personal feel is that OJ Simpson in many a sense reflects the actual American nation, because we have seen this desire and groping towards identity, a search for who am I, some debasement that took place some years ago, in some sense there's an intrinsic worthiness that has to be restored within the black individuals in America. And what we have seen with this whole trial is a collective support rallying around OJ Simpson, not so much him as a person, but about black, but being black, about blackness, which is an attitude, which is a way of thinking, which is a culture, which is a value system that you accept into your life. Now what has happened for himself also, it was a major lesson, because OJ now, who has all the time been wanting to be white, has discovered he's not white. He's now finally... OJ finally discovered that he's not white. The skin came down, he's a black man, and his support is amongst black...
And I couldn't have put it no better than myself. The South African brothers said it right. You know, OJ, he saw what that lesson would be, but hey, you know, listen to juice. He had to have, you know, his white women and what have you, and... Look, this is why it comes back to learning lessons from things, all right? Him, Jonathan Majors in present day, who I hope understands that if he's ever in another situation like that with one of them women, they're going to make sure they get him permanently. Because, see, let me tell you something about white supremacist America. They hated that they didn't get OJ for the murder of you know, Nicole Brown Smith there. And, you know, Ron Goldman, they hated that. So if you pass and they don't feel like they got one Negro, well, another dude, get you, Jonathan Majors. Let me tell you something right now, Michael B. Jordan, you better watch out, brother. The you brothers out there that like to, you know, be going over there with the alabaster women, all right? Is it worth it? Because we can see, this is the thing, we can always get lessons from everything. And I say the same thing to the sisters that run over there with Zaddy. You know how that end up for a lot of y'all that do that. When Zaddy get tired, a lot of times he kill everybody, okay? And they're in a system of white supremacy in the way that no matter what they do to us, they can get away with it. We can't even be suspected of doing something to them and get away with it. So see, this is why I have the image of our departed brother, Johnny Cochran, and our departed brother, OJ Simpson, up here. This right here, we are in short supply of competent attorneys to defend our people when we're presented with these accusations, because see, if we don't have competent defense, then we're at their mercy, okay? We're at their mercy. So I wanted to play those clips. A lot of y'all probably didn't see that or whatever. I thought that was very important to include in here to show how Johnny Cochran even went abroad to speak on what happened there. And see, 30 plus years later, these people see everything. That goes to show that this whole thing was them trying to frame this man, and they still don't want to concede that. That is nothing less, ladies and gentlemen, than demonic insanity. And I'm going to play something else that they can't get around, because they love to try to rewrite history, but unfortunately for them, there's a new black media over here today that's not going to let you rewrite history. I want y'all to check this out for those of you that don't remember.
And I think so the jury can see, I'll ask Mr. Simpson to stand. That's People 77. Sustained. People's 164A, is that the right hand glove? All right. All right. Thank you, counsel.
If I put this knit cap on, who am I? I'm still Johnny Cochran with a knit cap. And if you look at O.J. Simpson over there, and he has a rather large head, O.J. Simpson in a knit cap from two blocks away is still O.J. Simpson. It's no disguise. It's no disguise. It makes no sense. It doesn't fit. If it doesn't fit, you must acquit.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, couldn't have said it better myself. All right. The late, great Johnny Cochran made that legendary statement and did a brilliant job of putting the truth out with his fine display in that courtroom and just with nothing but the facts and the truth. And they hate that to this day. Okay. So now, here's what you got to understand. When these white supremacists, at the time passes, the reason why, see, they know that those of us that were alive back in that time, they know we know the truth. The reason why they keep on doing that is to try to confuse the younger generation that wasn't around. And see, this is why we must make sure that we don't allow them to rewrite history. Because, see, we're going to talk about something that I'm going to do an entire Children of the Chalk broadcast on. Oh, yeah, you know I ain't done with no children yet. Since they wanted my attention, they're going to get it. Oh, we're going to go back in the Wayback Machine because, see, this same reaction that they got now for the deceased O.J. Simpson, where's that same vitriol for this helper that's still in prison where she belongs? She deserves a rotten hell for what she did to her children. If you don't know who this is Susan Smith, the murdering mom. You know, she captivated the nation by saying a black man kidnapped her sons in a carjacking and the police knew she killed him. Oh, we finna take a look at some things over here tonight. Oh, yes, we are, ladies and gentlemen, because, see, I'm going to prove to you how demonically insane these people are when it comes to how they look at black people and how it's easy for them to just pin anything on us. Because, see, for those of us that were alive, and saw this in the beginning, too, when this woman first came out, Susan Smith, and made this claim that a black man did it, everybody in Alabaster America was going along with what she said. They were. I remember this very well. All of you that were alive during that time remember this very well. Oh, they were just looking for. And see, this is the danger about that. She made that lie up and they ran around like chickens with their head all cut off looking for any kind of black man that they think fit the description that she gave. And that put innocent black people in danger. See, this is how crazy these people are. And then come to find out this helper, demonic low-life scum that she is, killed her own babies. Family, we finna take a walk down memory lane. We finna look at some things. Oh, yes, we are. We finna look at some things tonight.
Can't sleep. I can't eat. I can't do anything but think about them. And I just want to hug them so bad. And tell them I love them.
Greg, what do you got?
It might be true that she wants to hug them. She wants to do this. She wants to do that. But she's eye blocking. There is not a single bit of grief. There's no concern, nothing in the forehead. There's no snot, no tears. It's the worst kind of fake cry. It's a, Scott, I'm so sorry. You really don't like what I did. That's all it is. This is garbage. Chase, what do you got?
Yeah, I agree with you. So this eye closure is not from the crying. This is exactly what you just said, Greg. This is avoidance. There's no movement here in the chin boss, which we always see when we see shame and grief. There's a hygienic gesture during the crying. And it's not to wipe tears, which is very unusual. So
I'm going to pause it right here. And yes, Alabaster America, you're going to really hate this because it's not the black man that's saying this. You got your own people calling out the lies of your community. So this is why I included this in here tonight. Oh, yes. Pay close attention to these behavioral experts as they study this lying language that she's got going on here that made it clear that she was full of you know what. OK, and he's right about that. If somebody is upset, see, these are the things that our people need to be trained to look for as far as them folks when they lying on anybody in that for that matter. If you distraught and upset, you're not making gestures, petting and patting your hair and stuff. They're going to do an excellent job of bringing this down because, see, who better than to know and expose the lies of their own women than them? Oh, let's let these fine white gentlemen speak.
Adjusting your hair while crying doesn't look very good. So she's kind of just pushing her hair back there. That's what we call in the behavior business, a hygienic gesture. And she said, I just want to hug them. And she has had a tough childhood. And I think there's a baton gesture she does with her hand as she's talking, her hands back here. I think it's her left hand. And what something that we always look for is things that don't line up. Scott talks about this in a lot of the other videos when a gesture doesn't really match up with a person's phrases. Desmond Morris called this a baton gesture. And what I think is interesting here is that the gesture doesn't match up with anything that's going on. It doesn't match up emotionally, tonally, like with the tone of her voice or the cadence or the words that she's saying. So I would like to invent a new a name for what we're seeing here where it doesn't match up with anything and just call it gesture arrhythmia. I think this is this gesture isn't associated with sadness or grief or loss or anything there. And that's all I got for this video. Mark, what do you see?
Here's what jumps out at me.
I can't sleep. I can't eat. I can't do anything.
I.
But think about them.
Them. Then the grooming that you were talking about there.
I just want to hug them so bad and tell them I love.
I, them, I. So there's way more eyes than them.
Let me pause it right here because Mark Bowden here in the lower right-hand corner, the man that's speaking, okay? I agree 100% with that because I. See, let's look at this. And heaven forbid any parent to have to lose a child or know what it's like to bury the child, it's supposed to be the other way around. If heaven forbid a parent lost their child, I couldn't imagine that. And I don't have kids, but boy, let me tell you something. It wouldn't be about I would be saying my baby's names. That would crush me to my very soul to even have to speak on. I don't even think I could speak on that in front of a camera. I'm going to be honest with you. I'm a very stoic and cold man, but boy, if I had children and that happened to mine, I would be out looking for who did it. I'm just going to be honest with you. Law enforcement would better catch up to them before I do, because see that I would be broken in a way that would not even be possible to put into words on this microphone. Okay. But if I was going to be speaking, most parents would be speaking their children's name or talking about them without, you know, all of that phoniness that she had going on. And then mostly talking about I mean, you wouldn't even know how to feel. That would put a part of you is gone from this world. And it would just numb your spirit in ways that just could not be described to the average person that hadn't been through that. You know what I'm saying? So he's on point with her calling her behavior out right here. So I'm going to let him continue. I want my people to pay close attention to how they're breaking this down here. Let it continue.
They're a collective. There's not even any names of the children. So it's very egocentric at this point. The male is very different from the female, different rhythm going on, not joining in with this crying, you know, even if it is, you know, kind of fake, he's not even joining in with anything real or fake here. And I think he gives a sour taste in his mouth as well. So I think there is some strong differences between the male and the female here. Female here, very self-centered in the description there. And the grooming, as you say, Chase, is just, it's just not applicable in this situation at all. Scott, what are you?
And see, I'm going to double down on agreeing with him on that because, see, if you were able to gather your wits and wherewithal to speak about something that tragic, you wouldn't give a damn how you look. You wouldn't even be in a place to care about what you look like. You just lost your babies, man, a part of you that you watched coming to this world that you love with everything that you are. If you're a parent that's worth a damn, like that degenerate low-life bag of slime, and makes you rot forever in piss for what she did. Because even though those are white children, those are babies, man, they didn't do nothing to nobody, man. They didn't deserve that. You think about how horrific. See, let me go here before I let them continue to go to show you why the hypocrisy of Alabaster America is so demonic. They talking about OJ, 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 an innocent man that didn't kill nobody. But you know this bitch killed her babies. They're not bringing her name back up. You think about how scared the little babies must have been for her to drive that damn car into that water. These are babies, man. They ain't do nothing to nobody. They're children. Thinking about all the things that make children happy. Now you think about their last moments when they in this car and it's going down, they scared and it's sinking down into that water and they crying and hollering for their mama. You boy, you wicked to do some shit like that. I'm going to tell you, her husband is a better man than me. Because you know what? I ain't going to even say what I would be trying to do. You got to be a soulless monster to do something like that, especially for the reason that she did it. So I had to put that part in there. I'm going to let this continue.
Go on this one.
All right. She's moving really slow. This lets us know that there's a lot going on up here. She's thinking through what she's going to say. She's not really experiencing these emotions, so we're not seeing them on her face. She's showing us what she thinks we want to see or should be seeing at this point. When you compare Susan with her husband, do this throughout all these videos when he's in there too. Dramatic. And everything is based on feel sorry for me. It's all about me and just feel sorry for me. You're right, Marcus. It's all about me at this point. And when you turn the sound off, as you'll see in all these videos, if you'll do this, she looks like she's retiring from a job somewhere, or these are the same faces you see and the same emotions you don't see that you're not seeing when someone's retiring or someone is leaving a job and they're telling everybody goodbye. That's what it looks like. It doesn't look like somebody who's grieving over their children. It doesn't look like that at all. The stress we're seeing is when she's moving slow and not looking up the camera and not connecting with anyone. So we're seeing a bunch of stress on her, rightfully so, because she's not telling the truth here, but she's sort of creating this. I think she had a pretty good idea of what she was going to say, but that was it. I don't think she rehearsed this at all before it came down to game time for showtime for her. All right.
Scott, I disagree with one thing you said fully.
What?
There's a lot going on in her head. I disagree.
Oh. Okay, I stand corrected.
Yeah, so there you have it from her own community talking about that murdering bag of dog shit, Susan Smith. But see, we're not done yet because, see, I have a point to prove about the demonic hypocrisy of white supremacist America that's celebrating the death of OJ Simpson, who didn't kill anybody, didn't kill his kids or anything like this heifer did here. If you thought that them breaking down her behavior was one thing, wait till you hear what I'm about to play for you next, family. This is going to underscore why I keep telling y'all, you cannot redeem these white supremacists that do these types of things, like celebrating OJ's death and still insisting that he's guilty of murder after all the evidence proved that this man was not. And we're going to get to some more of that, too, before this broadcast ends. But I want y'all to take a listen to what I'm about to play for you next. You're not going to believe this. If you didn't know this already, you're about to learn something regarding Susan Smith here. Oh, yeah, because, see, we're going to talk about who really did commit one of the most heinous murders that you could ever commit. You kill your own kids? Oh, now that's who there's a special place in hell for right there. But I'm going to let this play. I want y'all to take notes on this.
This morning, we're shining a spotlight on the case of Susan Smith. She was convicted back in 1995 for the murders of her two young boys. And next year, the murder mom is up for parole, but her family is not offering much support, saying they're not interested in helping her. And her ex-husband, David, says he plans to file an affidavit urging the parole board to keep her locked up. Wow, she's not getting support from her family. The ones that used to love her, well, she's got lots of folks that love her right now. She's been corresponding with about a half a dozen suitors. One man calling Smith, "Dearest Pookie," sent this letter in August. "Been thinking of you and miss you so much. Hoping I can do something for you soon. Anyways, feels like it's been so long since we talked." Later concluding, "Love you so much. It hurts. Your Pookie." Another man allegedly offered Smith a place to live if she is indeed granted parole. Let's break it down with a guy that knows this case very well, the man who prosecuted Susan Smith, Tommy Pope, with us. Good morning, sir. Let's start with her chances at parole. Your thoughts.
I always said I'd never get a job in Vegas handicapping because it's hard to know. You know, if you look at her behavior in prison, you know, the highlight or the low light was, you know, having sex with the guard. She's had some drug infractions and different things. So I think the notoriety of her case, coupled with the heinous nature, she probably doesn't make it next time, which will be a year from now. She'll be eligible in 2024. But stranger things have happened. I mean, you know, watching court, what you think a jury will do, what you think the parole board will do, you're never quite sure.
Absolutely.
So you hearing this right, family? This low-life child murdering degenerate is getting proposals from, I'm going to call them what they are, other low-life degenerate. And I can't even call them white supremacists, because I'm going to tell you why I can't call them true white supremacists according to their doctrine. If you're familiar with the 14 words, one of the primary tenets of those 14 words is to make a future for white children. Now, if you're going to be a true white supremacist, how are you going to be seeking to court a woman if she gets out of prison who you know murdered her children? How you going to want to build anything with her if you're a legitimate, full-fledged white supremacist and you adhere to them 14 words? You see the demonic insanity of white supremacy. You see that, family? See, when I present something to you, I like to make it stick over here with absolute logic, okay? But see, white supremacy isn't a logical thing. No white man that really adheres to them 14 words that you're a true white supremacist, what you going to do with a bitch that killing kids? White children, huh? What you going to do with that? Her own at that. What you going to have some kids with her? That's what you going to do? I'm make it make sense. I'm going to let it continue, though, because I want y'all to hear the rest of this, because she's supposed to be up for parole this year, and you would think that she wouldn't get it, but hey, in this system, you never know. They just may let that demonic child murdering piece of shit out. I would hope not, but stranger things have happened. Let's let it continue.
So let's talk about those infractions and to what extent they'll come in to the case. She had the relations with the guard was also they had a drug possession incident, disciplined in a couple times, but you know, she's been in a while. To what extent is this behavior, I guess, pull out the sex with the guard part, but
right,
how much of that is, you know, goes into the decision-making process? And I get, you can't, it's tough, every parole board sure. is different, et cetera.
Sure. I think that, you know, it's a factor. I mean, you hate to say it, but, you know, probably in prison-wise, that there's a lot worse infractions. You know what I mean? Assaulting another inmate, things of that nature. You don't see that. But I think, too, the parole board will be taking in the things that you let off with, the David Smith's information. You know, they'll hear from the prosecutor, probably Kevin Brackett that tried the case with me, that's the solicitor now. You know, they very well may solicit a letter from me. And my standard is, you know, I believe in truth and sentencing, that life should mean life. The jury thought she got life. That was what they, you know, were told in the courtroom, but that, you know, they did not know she was eligible for parole. And so my contact with them will be something to that extent, you know, that the sentence ought to mean what it says.
What do you mean? Why do you think she has so many suitors out there? It's common. We see it a lot with someone, a high profile defendant has people who fall for them for whatever reason. Anything about her that stands out?
You know, even back during the case, if you recall the days when we were searching for the carjacker and she was spending time.
Oh, no, I'm not going to let him get away with that. See how they try to just gloss over that? And see, this is why we have to chronicle and keep up with these things that happen to our people as foundational Black American freemen and as non-FBA people, if you got sense and on code. Look how he said, just tried to breeze over that, because I showed y'all that article headline for a reason. Excuse me. I showed y'all that article headline for a reason. She claimed that the carjacker was a Black man. That's what she claimed. Not just the carjacker. You see how he tried to do that, family? Huh? You see how he just tried to skate right over that part, huh? Oh, okay. Nah, buddy. Not over here in the new Black media. We're not going to let you just skate over that. No, she blamed that on a Black man. In fact, family, do y'all want me to put the link to that article in the chat? Because if y'all want me, you know what, let me get that. You know what? Let me get the link to that article. It won't take me but a second. I will put that in the chat room for those of you, especially if you're a young person, because I know most of you that are my age remember that, but there's a lot of young people that may not remember it. So you know what? Let me see if I can get that article right quick and put it in the chat room for a point of reference for anybody that's younger that doesn't know who Susan Smith is, because trust me, if you don't know who she is, the latest children of the chalk that I got coming up, oh, you gonna know exactly who she is by the time that's over with. Give me just a second, because I should have put that in the chat room the first time that I put that up here. Let me put this article on Susan Smith in the chat room so that any younger black person that finds this broadcast can look this up for themselves and become familiar with who this child murdering bag of dog shit is. I just put the article in the chat for the business. I'm going to put the link to it in there three more times for anybody that's a young person that's not familiar with Susan Smith, so you can get up to speed on that. And any of you that doesn't know about this case. So you see, they try to skate over the fact that you blamed it on a black man like you used to do. And then just after that happened, you know what was, well, it's not odd, but to go to show you what the way they don't really value our lives. After they proved that it was her that did it, there was no formal public apology to black America. It's like, oh, okay, she lied. Business as usual. Oh, hell no. No, no, no. We are not going to forget that, because, see, innocent black people could have been harmed and killed because of a white woman's lie, which is historically deadly to our community. Huh? Huh? Think about it now. Black Wall Street, anybody? White woman's lie. I could go on and on and show you where their lies have historically, Emmett Till, cost us our lives. George Stinney Jr., youngest person at 14 to be executed by electric chair because of a white woman's lie. Their lies are deadly. See, this is for me, knowing my history, this is why a lot of people are like, man, GBS, you, boy, you just don't like the white women that I called, man. And look, I don't care if some of them are cute. I'm not willing to risk what they've cost our people historically. Not me. I'm not going to do it. Look, history, I learned from my history. I learned from present day. Look at the lessons that has taught us right here in this broadcast that we're talking about. Whether it's the dearly departed OJ Simpson, rest in peace, brother, or the living Jonathan Majors, with they convicted him even though it wasn't jail time, but it shouldn't have been no charges. This man got footage of him running away from this woman. And yet in a system of white supremacy, well, we still got to hit you with something because she is white. Come on now. It's just not worth it for me, okay? So I put that article in the chat for anybody young that's not familiar with, or any older person that's not. I like to give you links to sources to things that I show you over here so you can do your own research and get brought up to speed. But I want y'all to listen to the rest of what this guy here is about to say in regards to that. We ain't going to let him skip over the fact that it was a black man. Oh, no.
With the SLED agents, you know, the state police officers, and they would pick her up, you know, to go take the polygraph, for example. She was flirty with them. I think she's got an ability to kind of be flirty, for lack of a better term, you know, and I think.
I got a better term for you. She's an alabaster turbo thigh. That's what she is. A demonic murdering turbo thigh. There's a better term for you. Blaming that shit on a black man, you demonic murdering scum, you.
I think that's what happened probably with the guard, you know, from what I've read. I remember one time with a SLED agent, you know, the kids are in the lake. She's going to take a polygraph, and she starts saying, I wish you and I were driving to the beach instead of, you know, driving to do this. It's such a beautiful day. And so she's always kind of had that ability with men, and I think she's just playing on that.
She's a siren.
Drawing them onto the rocks.
Yes. one of her suitors said publicly to the messenger, said that, I don't know why my messages were made public. I just find her interesting and misunderstood. She's not what you think she is. She's a good person who did something terrible. When
do you hear this insanity, family? You're not reading it. You didn't hear him read that wrong. It's right here on the screen. Let's read it. Quote, I didn't know that my messages were public. I just found her interesting and misunderstood. She's not what you think she is. Oh, really? She's not a convicted child murderer? She's a good person who did something terrible when she was young and not in her right mind. People can change, end quote. A white supremacist, well, I can't even say white supremacist, an alabaster man wrote this about her. So let's just break this down, how insane this is. She's misunderstood, even though it's proven beyond a reasonable doubt that she was the one that killed her kids and lied and blamed it on a black man. So he's saying that she's not what you think she is. Well, what the hell do you think she is? Then you have the audacity or the caucasity to say she's a good person. Last time I checked, if you're killing your own kids, you damn sure the furthest thing from a good person anywhere in remote fashion of that. Okay. Then she's not in her right frame of mind. Yeah. I would say that qualifies you as being demonically insane and batshit crazy. People can change. No, sir. Not with that. You killing kids? No, ain't no change from that. Just like if you a child predator, ain't no change from that. It's certain things that I don't think there's no redemption from that. But this is what they're writing her now. So I just wanted to go over that with y'all. This is what some of these people in the Alabaster community think of this child murdering demon here that violated one of the holy tenets of the 14 words of white supremacy. You're supposed to be creating a future for white children. How you going to create a future for them if you got helpers like this running around killing them? Let's let it continue.
When she was young and not in her right mind, people can change. That's pretty accurate with most. A lot of the folks in our prisons are inherently good people that did insanely horrible things, and it doesn't necessarily define their whole life. Correct?
I think that's.
Did you hear what he just said?
That's accurate. I think what that guy said is accurate. If we're gonna. You know, at least based on my faith, we're sure all seeking forgiveness for something and grace for something, you know. So I think, you know, people can change and, you know, if.
And that right there, ladies and gentlemen, is what you heard is why these people are doomed. See, y'all probably thought they was going to come down and criticize her. You know what? Let me play that back. I'm going to show you. This is why white supremacists, this is why you're doomed. Because even when you know that your people are guilty, you make excuses for them. And you, even though she's convicted, this is what you call them staying on cold. And I'm going to tell you why you should be ashamed of yourselves, you demonically insane white supremacists. She killed white children. What do I always tell y'all on this platform? The children of any race are its what? It's future. So according to your 14 words of white supremacy, you're supposed to be creating a future for white children and preserving it for them. How you gonna do that if you got child murderers? I'm taking this back. I want y'all to hear these excuses they about to make. Y'all probably thought they was being sarcastic. Oh no. Mm-mm. They make excuses for the lowest of the low amongst them. And that's one thing that we in black America don't do.
Publicly to the messenger said that I don't know why my messages were made public. I just find her interesting and misunderstood. She's not what you think she is. She's a good person who did something terrible when she was young and not in her right mind. People can change. That's pretty accurate with most. A lot of the folks in our prisons are inherently good people that did insanely horrible things.
Oh, he'll say they're inherently good people unless they're black, though. Oh, yeah, we're going to throw that part in there. That applies to everybody unless they're black, though, right? Even if they're acquitted and found not guilty of murder like OJ Simpson. Yeah, I got to probably put that in there. But I want y'all to listen to this now. I'm running it back so that your ears are not playing tricks on you. Listen to what they're about to say here, making excuses for this child murdering demon.
And it doesn't necessarily define their whole life. Correct.
I think that's accurate. I think what that guy said is accurate. If we're gonna, you know, at least based on my faith, we're sure all seeking forgiveness for something and grace for something, you know. So I think, you know, people can change, and you know, if these, you know, guys make that choice and want to befriend her, you know, I don't think that's inaccurate. You know, the first thing we always think, I was thinking of the case you had the other week. On the death where the guys, I guess, went back to prison in Peru, and he's got a wife and kid down there, but he's in prison. And, you know, so some people are drawn to that. I don't know whether it's the spotlight or the intrigue, or, you know, maybe they are wired to help those that they feel like have not gotten a fair shake. But I remember back early, Susan had kind of a Facebook page or something like that, and she had suitors back then, too.
Yeah, Natalie Holloway case and Johan Vandersloot you're
that
referring
was it.
To.
That
yeah.
was it.
It is. It's amazing. So let's say she does, achieve her goal and get out on parole. Knowing what you know about her, is this someone that you would feel comfortable being amongst us?
you know, some people can get out and go on and live their life. You know, some people have become institutionalized. I think she made a horrible, horrible choice and committed a heinous crime. And, you know, ultimately, I guess now at this point, the parole board and the jury have decided, you know, what that punishment should be. And so I probably would not have her over to my house, nor would she probably want me to come over to hers. So that's about all I could say about that.
That makes sense. In all the cases that you've prosecuted, does this one stand out? Is this one that obviously, you know, you had the notoriety of it, so inherently it's right. going to be, you know, always brought up like we're doing today. But is this one up there in terms of things you think about?
Well, I actually don't. I say tongue in cheek. I remember, you know, one time, you know, because I went on, had other cases, other careers, other people on death row. But I remember, you know, every time something would happen with Susan Smith, people would call me and go, you know, well, I heard she was pregnant. And so my running joke was, she may be, but I didn't do it. You know, but so we've had, I'll always be the Susan Smith prosecutor, for better or worse. You know, for me, the case was a loss. I was seeking the death penalty because I felt strongly if David Smith had committed it, the jury, you know, people would want death. If the African-American guy had committed it, people wanted death. So I just, you know, thought.
Oh, now I got to stop him right there. Did you catch that, family? If the African-American guy had committed it, there was no African-American guy. There was no black man. The bitch made that shit up. You see how they just kind of like they tried to gloss over saying that she blamed the black man in the beginning of this. And then as if there was an actual black man that did something. No, motherfucker. It wasn't no African-American. See, this is why you have the black media over here. We don't let stuff like that go. Nah, man. See, this is why our work is far from done. This is why you must remind your black children. And I put this in here for a reason in tonight's broadcast to show you that, hey, racism and white supremacy is alive and well. And you are the main target.
She ought to be fed out of the same spoon. So that kind of brings me back to the, you know, she should serve a life sentence.
Interesting. Yeah, that makes perfect sense. Tommy Pope, thank you. You're associated with lots of things, not just Susan Smith. That's for sure.
Court TV.
So there you have it, family. Yeah. So you see, I had to take the time to really break that down thoroughly to show you how demonically insane the people that's trying to actually get with this woman who murdered her own children. Then the interviewer and the prosecutor sitting up here making excuses for her. On the fence, one side or the other. Had that been an actual black man that did that, they wouldn't be saying none of that stuff. Talking about no grace and forgiveness and all this other stuff. And even though he said he was seeking the death penalty, trust me, man, his tune would have been totally different if he would have did this interview about that, and there actually had been a black man, which there wasn't. But see, we're not done yet. We're going to come back to our good brother, Dearly Departed, Johnny Cochran, and OJ Simpson here. For you white supremacists that try to rewrite history, I got something for you. Because see, y'all think that, you know, I don't know why you would think Gen X would forget, because see, that's the main generation that grew up watching the OJ trial along with some of the boomers, okay, the older boomers. If you think that we were going to forget, you must be out your rabbit mind. We must play and remind them exactly what really happened, family. So without further ado, we're going to put this right back in their faces. I'm not going to interrupt this at all.
If I put this knit cap on, who am I? I'm still Johnny Cochran with a knit cap. And if you look at O.J. Simpson over there, and he has a rather large head, O.J. Simpson in a knit cap from two blocks away is still O.J. Simpson. It's no disguise. It's no disguise. It makes no sense. It doesn't fit. If it doesn't fit, you must acquit.
Now, you saw that, family. You saw that, right? So there's something else I want to play for you. It's going to take me a second to get this because, see, I need to put this in here. Because it's necessary, okay? Oh, it is very necessary, ladies and gentlemen, because, see, they like to think that we don't have any sense, okay? They like to think that we don't remember how things actually were in actual history, but oh, no, no, no. We keep up with everything over here in the media. So give me a second to pull something else up here. Because, see, I would be remiss if I didn't play this. Oh, I'm definitely going to play it. I'm going to go in here in my archives, and I got to pull out something that I knew they don't want us to remind them of. But, see, this goes to show you that the demonically insane white supremacists that think that everybody is just like them and that nobody remembers history or anything of that nature, oh, you're highly mistaken when you're dealing with us over here in the black media. Oh, I got something that I'm going to play for you, ladies and gentlemen. I sure am. It's as soon as
Detective
I find
Furman,
it.
Would you please resume the witness stand?
Oh, yes. I'm going to play something for you. Hold on just a second. Let me set this up right. Okay, hold on. Wait,
all right,
just
good afternoon,
a second
Detective.
Here.
Good afternoon, Your Honor.
Make sure I got it where it needs to be.
Mr. Allman, you may proceed.
I have a bit of an issue here. Bear with me, ladies and gentlemen, because I want y'all to hear this. Wait, just
was the testimony that you gave in this case completely truthful?
I want to make sure that I set this up right. Y'all not going to hear me talking for a minute because I'm going to take the time to adjust something. Okay, now we finna play something right quick. Cause see, we got to remind these people of what actually really happened and the truth about it. So what I'm gonna do, I'm gonna take this back and I'm gonna play this back in its entirety here. I'm gonna make sure y'all can hear this right. So give me just a second to adjust this. Because see, we're not gonna get out of here without recounting real history and telling the whole truth about exactly what happened with the OJ Simpson verdict. This is going to be the anti-black racist, white supremacist, race soldier, Mark Furman, that you're about to hear. Now, for those of you that are young that don't know who Mark Furman was, he was the lead detective that was responsible for collecting the evidence to bring against O.J. Simpson during the trial. I want y'all to hear this. And see, this is going to be a good history and homework lesson for those of you that are young, that are listening to this on live or on the playback. If you understand what the Fifth Amendment is, you're going to understand the significance of this clip I'm about to play. Ladies and gentlemen, take notes on this.
Would you please resume the witness stand? All right. Good afternoon, Detective.
Good afternoon, Your Honor.
You're reminded, sir, that you are still under oath. Mr. Allman, you may proceed.
Detective Furman, was the testimony that you gave in this case completely truthful?
I wish to assert my Fifth Amendment privilege.
Have you ever falsified a police report?
I wish to assert my Fifth Amendment privilege.
Is it your intention to assert your Fifth Amendment privilege with respect to all questions that I ask you?
Yes.
I only have one other question.
What was that, Mr. Allman?
Detective Furman, did you plant or manufacture any evidence in this case?
I assert my Fifth Amendment privilege.
There you heard it. Furman the Vermin, racist, degenerate, white supremacist. By the way, I would not even attempt to play the recording where they caught him saying the N-word over and over, over 40 times. That was the so-called lead detective. And if you know anything about the case, he pled the Fifth because he didn't want to incriminate himself. You heard the question that Judge Lance Ito, the judge there, asked him, did you plant any evidence in the case? I plead the Fifth. Mm-hmm. And you gonna tell me that O.J. Simpson was guilty? Oh, no. No, see, we gonna honor and remember our brother here. This man was a great athlete. He was not a perfect man. No one is. But he will go down as one of the greatest running backs of all time. And my condolences to his family. And I don't even wish bad on the ones that were killed. Nicole Smith and our Run Golden. We don't. Because, see, we actually have some type of moral fiber to us as black folks. We actually do. Okay? So, with that being said, family, we're going to remember and honor the man for who he was and his accomplishments. And I'm going to tell you white supremacists something that are celebrating this man's death. Oh, yeah. See, your time is coming. You are speeding up your exit on this planet. That's exactly what you're doing. You're speeding it up. You're not going to be able to get out of the judgment that's coming your way while you're trying to celebrate this man's death. You're going to pay for that, okay? You're going to pay for that. We don't even have to do anything to you. Your time is coming, because see, I'm going to show you what we're going to remember about our brother O.J. Simpson. We're going to remember this about the brother O.J. Simpson, okay? Let me put this on the screen before we close out here tonight. We're going to remember O.J. Simpson with his black family. I really wish that he could have stayed with his first wife there, with black family, black children, but that's not the way that worked out. We're going to remember him for the good that he accomplished, okay? Because see, if you're going to try to hold O.J. Simpson up as some monster, which he didn't commit those murders, you better start looking at your Susan Smiths that you got out there, because there's more of her out there that's constantly killing your so-called future every day. It's more Susan Smiths out there, and I got an upcoming broadcast on her. But this is what we're going to also remember, too. In addition to O.J. with his black family, oh, yeah, I'm going to tell you what you white supremacists are going to remember. Oh, yeah, this is what y'all going to remember. Oh, yeah, boy, take a good look at it, white supremacists. Oh, yeah, I'm going to put this in here, because, see, rest in power, Juice. Juice, the reason why you hate the Juice so much, even in death, he got all the white women that you wanted to have. Now, they're not my cup of tea, but, hey, there was one that wouldn't touch you with a doggone 10-foot pole if you was on fire. And he got the ones that you wanted. He sure did. Yes, he did. Let me put the brother love voice on. Yes, he did, brothers and sisters. And see, this is the image that just creeps up in their souls. It terrifies them. Not even just this one. Brothers and sisters, can I ask you a question? Can I show you the image that really terrifies them, brothers? Can I show you? Do y'all want to see the image that they're really worried about? You know, the one that's going to keep them up late at night? Ladies and gentlemen, give me a thumbs up if I can show you what they're really scared of before we get out of here tonight, my brothers and sisters. Because it's all about love over here. They need to get that hate out their hearts. Let me show you what really terrifies them. They're worried about this image right here. Yes, they are, brothers and sisters. This is the one that keeps them up late at night. Instead of hell where they want OJ to be, they're terrified that he's in white heaven. That's right. White condo heaven. That's that, and probably smiling just like this. And you know, OJ, hey, what's up, Twitter world? This is OJ reporting in from heaven with all these white women that you couldn't get in life. Yeah, that's what they don't want to see, ladies and gentlemen. That's what they don't want to see. This is the image right here. Our brother OJ Simpson up there in white condo heaven, you know what I'm saying, with all the white women that they wish they could have had in life. And that's the one that terrifies them. So I had to put that in there for the white supremacists. And all, you know, jokes that we had over here and everything at the end of the broadcast, and all seriousness, no, rest in power to their brother. Condolences to his family and his children. And the lesson for us is, even though the man was not perfect, we learn from his flaws. And we also learn from the inspiration and the accomplishments that the brother set forth that can never be taken out of history. Okay? So I know I had a couple of laughs that night at the end of the broadcast tonight, but I think we all got our point across with everything that we reviewed over here. So with that said, salute to everybody that contributed to the broadcast. Okay, whether you're catching it live or on the playback, much respect to all of you. Black First, salute, and I will see you all in future content.
This is the 50th anniversary of hip-hop, and we still have a lot of discrepancies as far as the origins of hip-hop, a lot of claims, who did what, who was the first this, who was the this and that, and such and such. But at the end of the day, we need a definitive story, all right? And that story can only be told by the founders of this culture.
Like, everything was being driven and influenced by young, black, American culture. Like, the slang, the style of dress, the initial music that we chose.
Look at all the boroughs. You got, you know, Money Making Manhattan and Money Earning Mount Vernon and Crooklyn. The Bronx was the boogie down Bronx. We was partying up there.
I am Coke LaRock, the first MC of hip hop. First cat to pick the mic up.
I introduced rapping to the turntable because when I came with it, nobody in the world was doing it. I'm right after Rudy Ray Moore.
They want to come in the mix, they want to say, we started. No, you didn't. What came to be known as hip hop was solely an African American creation.
What would you get out of some Jamaican toast? What is that? I've never heard of a rapper use a Jamaican toast or a Jamaican flu as a rhyme. I've never heard of it, and I don't know where that myth came from.
My name is Legendary Kane Trixie from the Bronx, BX from the West Side. I am the first break dancer.
And that narrative that hip hop has had three founding fathers, that's been rolling for the last almost 30 years, which isn't true. You don't have just three people who created hip hop. Hip hop was created by a number of different people.
I am the grandfather, the godfather of the graffiti culture. I am the first element of hip hop.
The roots of hip hop being Jamaican, absolutely false.
My name is MC Sha-Rock. I am a founding member of the MC/rap culture.
Cassette tapes was the internet of our time. It just traveled around by hand.
I know for a fact that the B-boy stand started from the gods, the five percenters that would be at the jams back in the days who were acting as security.
If they get the real truth of how it all was created, then so many lies would not be able to be in existence.